let's do it on paint to give an example, because saying words is not always the same. But here's me. Here's my waypoint. And maybe here's the closest ally. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to repel from the ally, and I'm going to attract the waypoint, which means I'm going to end up having a bunch of guys that are having requirements, like everything in these kinds of dynamic systems. Because in the end, you'll want to expect them to find balance between these things. Because, frankly, one of the things they want to be at the waypoint, but they don't want to be next to their friends. So that automatically means that they can't be satisfied, like a lot of people are. So you can see here the repulsion curve. So if there are allies, then it will locate the closest ally using this function that I wrote, very simple. And then it will add to the goal location -3 of the direction of the closest ally. What the heck does that mean? That's just saying repel. My goal location started to move, and then I moved it toward the waypoint some amount. And it will be more or less depending on where the waypoint was. And now I'm going to take the ally direction, this direction, and I'm going to subtract that from this. So now I'm going away from the ally toward the waypoint to get to the end. So in the final analysis, this is my new goal location, which is the sum of a bunch of weighted added directions. And now I'm going to go that way. I'm going to get both toward the waypoint and away from my end. So this direction may have been quite close to or the same as this direction directed to waypoint. But when you keep doing it over and over, those little edge cases where a small difference makes you go one way or the other start to become significant. And so you can do it just simply like this, where you only care about where the ally that's closest is, and you only care about the weighting of the of where you're going. But wait just a second. There are so many things you can add to this, and that I did add when I wrote my guidance form 2, which is going to end the lecture. So let's do all the things that you can repel or attract. There's enemies, and you know, you repel or attract them based on how many there are. There's mine, and if they're yours, you know, you want to be right next to mine, you want to be behind them, you want to be sort of in a clump of them. You want to laying mine. I mean, if you're in a laying mines mode, then you don't really want to stand on a mine, because then you can't lay one. You're on one already. So, being on your current goal. So you can imagine making the following system so cool. Somebody in this room needs to do this. I was going to do it for today, but ran out of time. Is do the following. So, here's what always happens when I write players. I've got a sentence, and people start laying mines around the sentence. I think you started today, where they were like laying these mines, and the mines sort of reached a certain amount, and the robots were only like out here, and so that was it. Like, I didn't get any more mines. But here's what you could do. You could say, have the headquarters, which might be, say, down here, have it say, if, let's do this. Oh my goodness, watch this. It's gonna work. Headquarters. If there are a lot of mines near the rally point, and it can do this very easily, you know how to do it? There's a really, really handy function. Don't do the following. Here's what you were probably thinking. What you might have done is, like, send all the allied mines, or whatever the function name is, and then, like, parse through that list and find the ones that are close to the waypoint. You don't have to do that. You don't have to do that at all. You can see here in the documentation, under robot controller, there's a method that really helps. There's send mine location, and it'll let you specify a center, a radius, and a key. Let's put that on here. You definitely want to be using this, so that all you've got to do is have the headquarters. And why would you use the headquarters? Just so that it doesn't have to be done again and again. the headquarters is going to test, is going to say how many mines are there when this X is the center, and I'm looking within some radius, and you can just expand the radius turn by turn, how many mines there are until it starts to drop off, or you can just like set it at a given radius, but a previous radius. So yeah, let's do it that way, and you say how many of my mines are in this circle, and you say if there are full mines in the circle. And you can do that pretty easily because the circle is defined by a radius squared, right? So expected mine is like pi r squared, right? That's the number of tiles, but r squared we already have, pi as an integer is equal to 3. And so we can just say the number of expected mines equals 3 times the radius squared. And so that's also a little bit less than pi. And so if you're like mostly filled of mines in that circle, then so if the detected mine is greater than or equal to expected mine in a full area, then expand the mine list. Okay, wait, how am I expanding the mine list? Well, here you go. Right now, the function looks like this, the word repulsion and attraction. It looks like the following. So if this is the distance x from center E, and this is the repulsive force, the attractive force was greater the farther you got from the center. But you can imagine, so that's going to push everybody towards the middle. But you don't have to do that. You could just as easily have the headquarters is telling everybody about 5 message systems what this looks like, and they could very well tell them to make it a little bit more like this. So let's say that you've already put mine out to this ring, already put mine here, and you've detected them using the headquarters. So now you want everybody to show up here. And you can very simply do that. All you've got to do is make the forces look like this. What kind of, is that right? No, we want it. Yeah. Well, that's the energy. And the force is this. Yeah, the attractive force is this. This is exactly a spring. That's a spring from physics. And that will make them go toward it if they're inside, because they will go opposite the direction of this vector from the origin. And they'll make it go away if they're in the other direction, and you get the idea. That's a pretty neat idea. You can have them spread out in a circle and sort of maintain that, you know, that sort of positional authority, as it were. Very, very cool. We are also going to talk about some other awesome things the headquarters can tell them, even though our mouths are watering. Check the neighbors, okay? You can avoid this. You can avoid mines. You can avoid the enemy. You can do those things. There's no more directions to talk about that. So now let's go back a little bit and talk about how the headquarters can help you achieve a given shape. The headquarters can signal when the enemy has artillery. How is the headquarters going to know? Well, it could receive the message from somebody else that notices the hit points have dropped by 20 or 40, or it could just, like, locate an artillery. Like, if you actually see that you walk past one, then you could say, there's an artillery there. I should start repelling my other units. Like, they should start spreading out, because if they all come together, they're going to take a lot more damage. They're going to take, instead of 40 damage for just one hit, they're going to take 8 splash damage as well. And